and welcome to the second Rosalie Heller Memorial Lecture. In 2018, the Los Alamos Arts Council created this lecture series to honor the many ways in which Rosalie contributed to the life here in Los Alamos, and most especially to the music in Los Alamos. You have no idea how much work went into getting this lecture into existence. Almost all the credit goes to Chris Monteith, the executive director of the Los Alamos Arts Council. In addition to all the over a year's work of preparation, this month she is saddled with pumpkins and scarecrows, but nevertheless, it's all coming together. Two other persons who contributed to this evening are Marlene Hamilton and Howard Granzo. Rosalie was one of the founders of the Los Alamos Arts Council and also of the organization Living Treasures of Los Alamos. But it was in music where she made her greatest mark. Sharing her love of music with others was one of the joys of her life. Some of you may have attended one or more of the over 100 chamber music concerts that took place in this room. They were called the Coffee House Concert and are fondly remembered by those who were able to be present for them. Any piece of chamber music that was performed here that had a piano part to it, Rosalie played that part. But of course, there were other members of this chamber music group, originally a group of five from Los Alamos. I don't see Patty Bruxton here this evening. I know that Kay Noonan didn't make it for the evening. But there were two other regulars in addition, and many guest artists from all over the country. Rosalie also taught music to pupils of all ages, from 5 to 95. Yes, 95 there was one. And as a radio host, she created skipped programs which covered all different aspects of music and musicians. She was also the artistic director of the Los Alamos Concert Association for many years. And during those years, many of the leading performers in music came to Los Alamos to perform at our concerts. Now I want to tell you a little bit about Dr. Chris Wood, who will be introducing this evening's speaker. Chris got his PhD from Yale in 1973 and then took a postdoctoral position at the Walter Reed Army Research Institute. Afterwards, he returned to Yale to join the faculty. He had joint appointments in the departments psychology, neurology, and neurosurgery. Moving a few years ahead from there into the 1980s, there was a group at the laboratory here in Los Alamos that was doing some very interesting research in a number of different areas. The one I want to focus on is the study of imaging human brain function. You are all familiar with techniques like MRI and X-rays that are used to learn about the structure of your spine, your arm, or your brain. But this method was being used to learn about the actual functioning of the human brain. It was soon realized that in order to make real progress, it would be necessary to have a neuroscientist to head it up. And this is where Chris Wood comes into the picture. In 1989, he became the group leader of this group. And under his leadership, the research really blossomed. Together with research from other institutions, the techniques that were developed during those years have since become important in research and also clinically. During the year 2000-2001, Chris served as the director of the National Foundation for Functional Brain Imaging, a collaboration of several institutions applying these techniques to mental illness. In 2005, Chris left Los Alamos to become the vice president of the Santa Fe Institute, where he remained until 2016, when he retired for health reasons. So please join me now in welcoming Chris Wood.
For that very generous introduction. That's the longest introduction that any introducer is likely to receive. Thank you, Leon. It's a great honor to be able to introduce this evening's speaker, James M. Keller, to whom I will turn in a moment. But first, I want to say a few words about the singular individual whom this lecture series memorializes, Rosalie Heller. I met Rosalie shortly after I moved to Los Alamos in 1989, as Leon just said. Learning that I enjoyed choral singing, Rosalie immediately said, "I've got a group for you," and introduced me to the Sangre de Cristo Chorale, with whom I still sing. I auditioned, joined the chorale, and it was in the chorale that I met my wife, Nancy, who is here with me tonight. I'm glad you're here. We will celebrate our 25th wedding anniversary this December. So thank you, Rosalie. In the ensuing years, I had the pleasure of listening to a number of Rosalie's coffeehouse concerts, sharing post-performance thoughts and discussions about concerts we have both attended. I think we had a somewhat different view on one performance of the Goldberg Variations, as I recall. Hers was surely more astute than mine. And I had many opportunities to enjoy the fruits of Rosalie's work as artistic director for the Los Alamos Concert Association over the years. And Nancy and I are also personally very grateful for Rosalie's and Leon's friendship and warm hospitality over the years. Spending an evening in the Heller's home was a real treat indeed. Thank you, Rosalie. And thank you, Leon. Our distinguished speaker this evening is James M. Keller, who many of you will recognize, as I did, as the music critic and critic at large at the Santa Fe New Mexican. Perhaps you enjoy, as I have, his many informed and probing reviews and commentaries. This man knows music, you might have said, as I have many times. It should therefore have come to note as no surprise to any of us that James is in his 25th year as program annotator for the New York Philharmonic, is program annotator for the San Francisco Symphony, only 19 years, author of program notes and numerous other documents for leading international music organizations, and he was also the music and recordings correspondent for the New Yorker from 1990 to 2000. Just another talented refugee to northern New Mexico. I want to call specific attention to Mr. Keller's award-winning 2010 book, Chamber Music, A Listener's Guide, published by Oxford University Press. I'm sure that Rosalie, as a lover and keen performer of chamber music, would have relished it. Listener's Guide includes analysis and commentary on, if I've counted correctly, 190 chamber works of over 56 composers. Of Listener's Guide, renowned chamber performers Wu Han and David Finkel, who have been here to Los Alamos under Rosalie's auspices at least once, if not more. Of Listener's Guide, David and Wu Han write, James Keller's engaging essays do exactly what great program notes should. They transport us inside classical music's fascinating scenarios of creation. Choosing intelligently from myriad possible details, Keller weaves a story about each work that has the feeling of a suspense novel, where the thrilling final chapter will be our listening experience. Now, you might think from this and many other accolades that Keller's writing, no matter how perceptive and illuminating, veers a little excessively toward the highbrow. Well, nothing could be further from the truth. Here are just two examples to the contrary, names omitted to protect the guilty. Quote, "It is an outstanding masterpiece, but you wouldn't have guessed it from this lackluster reading. It sounded like the players had just rolled out of bed and weren't yet ready to go to work. The musicians kept nicking strings they didn't mean to, which is the quartet equivalent of having a bad hair day. Not the mark of flawed character, but not very attractive either." And the second example is the epitome of concision. The concert began with Frank Bridges' Lament for Two Violas, a dispiriting piece I think that only two violists could like. Let me conclude at the other end of Mr. Keller's evaluative scale, this from his review of The Revolution of Steve Jobs, an opera which premiered at the Santa Fe Opera here in 2017. Quote, "If opera is going to grow as an art form in the 21st century, it's going to need more than directors imposing quirky concepts on the familiar repertoire or composers retracing well-worn tracks of neo-romanticism. It will need the kind of musical and dramatic persuasiveness of Mason Bates' The Revolution of Steve Jobs. Like all of the finest operas, it is animated by a stimulating plot. It is brimful of compelling music, and not less important, it has ample heart." I think those are goals for the future of opera and for the future of music in general that Rosalie Heller would wholeheartedly endorse. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming James Keller, whose title tonight, as you can see, is Living Within Our Music.
That warm welcome, ladies and gentlemen, and Chris for that beautiful introduction, and Leon for that beautiful introduction to Chris. I consider it a great compliment to have been invited to present the Rosalie Heller Memorial Lecture this year, which, as you have heard, honors the achievements of a woman who contributed immensely to the musical life and the ongoing cultural health of Los Alamos. Let us be clear, this is a memorial lecture, not a memorial service, and it's a good thing. I would be at a tremendous disadvantage if my task was to eulogize Rosalie Heller, because the sad fact is that I never met her. I regret that. But after her husband, Leon, and the Los Alamos Arts Council invited me to join you here to spend an evening, at least I met up with Leon for a wonderful lunch, and he shared all manner of reminiscences of Rosalie. And as you have already heard some of these things, and I see that a bit of her biography is printed in the program as well, I'm glad of that. And you know that when the Hellers moved here from Brooklyn in the mid-1950s, Rosalie started giving piano lessons, and that she guided the hands of more than 300 piano pupils up and down the keyboard through the ensuing six decades. That's 3,000 fingers that she kept track of. And I know that a few of those fingers must be in the room tonight. Can we have a show of hands of the, a show of fingers of there? Well, we have, I think, 30 fingers. No, we have 40 fingers. Going, going, sold. 40 fingers that were trained by Rosalie Heller in this room tonight. I think that that's a living legacy right here. You may know that here at the Fuller Lodge, and Leon talked about this, she presented many lectures on music and the so-called coffee house concerts, where the place was set up cabaret style with little dining tables for people to enjoy chamber music in a relaxed atmosphere, with Rosalie herself serving as pianist. And when we first started talking about this evening, I said, oh, do you think we could set up the room that way? But we thought maybe we needed to fit in a few more people, and so we didn't. Maybe another time, because that must have been a fun event when those went on. And of course, she was for nearly 20 years, as Leon said, the artistic director of the Los Alamos Concert Association, which continues to this day, going from strength to strength. These are all terrific achievements. But here's the thing that struck me most powerfully about what I learned about Rosalie Heller. In the face of adversity, she just kept going with her musical pursuits. Later in life, she was diagnosed with rheumatoid arthritis. Now, that would be a challenge for anyone, but a very deep blow for a pianist whose artistry depends to the nth degree on the most subtle control of hand position and muscle action of the fingers. So what did she do? Did she give up? No. The point arrived where she acknowledged that she could no longer perform as a pianist, and she became a broadcaster instead, hosting this weekly classical music program for a decade on radio station KRSN right here in Los Alamos. And that is something wonderful about great music. It rolls down a wide highway, and it allows you to change lanes. It can be a part of your world under pretty much any circumstances. You can appreciate it as a performer. You can appreciate it as a listener. You can enjoy it in solitude, or you can share it with others. You can take a break from it, and it'll still be there waiting patiently when you decide to return. If you reach an ability where you can be a performing musician, you can also change lanes to spend time as a teacher, or as a concert producer, or as a broadcaster, or so many other things, all under the umbrella of great music. And it just keeps on enriching you. The history of music offers many examples of figures who advanced along the diverse pathways offered by music, sometimes pursuing just one musical discipline at a time, sometimes several at once. Sometimes they did so because they were so consumed by music that they were driven to engage with it from as many angles as possible. And sometimes they shifted from one musical discipline to another because of changes that they encountered, perhaps changes in their lives, changes in personal circumstances, perhaps because of changes in the musical world itself. But over and over, we see that great music inhabits a large tent. It's a domain that is not at all constrictive. For anybody who falls beneath the spell of great music, it allows plenty of space for them to roam far and wide while living within their music. Now, since Los Alamos is a community that oozes science out of its pores, I should not neglect to point out that many people, through the course of history, would have considered it obvious that all of us lived within music all the time, because that was a fundamental pillar of scientific understanding. Some of the earliest Greek philosophers hinted at the idea that the universe was ordered by the same numerical, mathematical proportions that produce specific musical harmonies. We find this expressed by Greek philosophers way back to the 6th century BCE, including Pythagoras. There he is. And he demonstrated how different tones result from geometric relationships, say the various length of strings or the sizes of bells. Scientists could view him as the father of acoustics. But he went a step further, and he related these mathematical proportions to harmonies within the human soul and within the universe itself. He argued, and this is from one of his treatises, he said, if earthly objects, such as strings or pieces of metal, make sounds when put in motion, so too must the moon, the planets, the sun, and even the highest stars. As these heavenly objects are forever in motion, orbiting the earth, surely they must be forever producing sound. Music and mathematics became viewed as parallel representatives of cosmic harmony, the music of the spheres, many called it. And Plato soon picked up on this idea and he promoted it. He dealt with the problem inherent in the fact that nobody could hear this music, but he explained that away by saying that we had all heard this cosmic harmony since the moment that we were born, and so that therefore we were desensitized to it. Well, now, not everybody bought that argument. In fact, Plato's pupil, gentleman by name of Aristotle, he objected to it, but that was not enough to dethrone the concept, and it actually gained a very strong following, a resurgence during the Renaissance. For centuries, the ultimate argument for many scientific beliefs was because Plato said so. And as a result, centuries of thinkers embraced this idea that humankind lived within a shell, a kind of a shell of musico-mathematical proportions, that we literally lived within music. Now, of course, today we smile at all of this, and except for our friends up in Taos, where many do claim to hear the hum, we view it as nothing more than charming poppycock. But it did have a huge influence on intellectual history, not least through the fact that all through the Middle Ages, and in some quarters even beyond, the educational curriculum consisted of two divisions, the trivium and the quadrivium, which today we would call, respectively, the humanities and the sciences. The three disciplines of the trivium were grammar, logic, and rhetoric. And the four disciplines of the quadrivium were arithmetic, geometry, astronomy, and music. So to the ancients, music was viewed as a science rather than an art. Music has long since crossed over to the other side, of course, at least for the most part, although the modern discipline of music theory certainly straddles the domains of music and mathematics. But of course, that's all theoretical. So I would like to shift away from the theoretical plane and instead to some material very much anchored in real life experiences and specifically in the history of music. And now, as you heard a bit earlier, the backbone of my professional life is that I'm the program annotator for two of our nation's greatest orchestras, the New York Philharmonic and the San Francisco Symphony, as well as many smaller musical organizations. And what that means, there aren't very many people who have that title behind their name, so I should explain that what that means principally is that I keep busy writing essays about compositions that those ensembles will be performing. And then those essays appear in their printed programs and on their websites week after week. So I'm basically the storyteller for those musical organizations, approaching our repertoire from all sorts of different angles. And I want to share some stories from the annals of music history that suggest how music served as an anchor for some notable figures who had to adapt to changing circumstances, who had to face adversity. And along the way, we'll do a little bit of listening, some to pieces that you may know well, and some to pieces that you probably don't know. So let us begin.
With him.
Those of you who have chosen to be music lovers need to brace yourselves to hear a lot of Beethoven during the coming year or two. He was born in December of 1770, so that means that next December, December a year from now, is going to be his 250th birthday. Well, the classical music world hardly neglects Beethoven under normal circumstances. I think more than once I've written it, wrote when I was writing for the New Mexican, I wrote, well, it's another Beethoven festival year, because everybody performs Beethoven all the time. But just you wait. These coming 2 years are going to be really something, because the classical music world just loves to celebrate round number birthdays, and it also has a strong tendency to jump the gun on those celebrations. So the Beethoven festivities are already underway this season, 2019-20, and it will continue just as strong or even stronger in 2020-21, which is when the birthday actually falls. Now, since we're at the beginning of the Beethoven celebrations, I thought it might be appropriate to spend some time with you looking at the beginnings of Beethoven's career. There has never been a time since the turn of the 19th century when Ludwig van Beethoven did not tower monumentally in the consciousness of music lovers. But of course, nobody could have predicted that until precisely then, until right at the turn of the 19th century. He was born in the city of Bonn, Germany. It was then an independent electorate within the general region recognized as Germany, although the unified nation of Germany would not exist until well after his lifetime. Historians have tended to paint his father, Johann van Beethoven, as an ogre. Although in the past few decades he's been viewed with greater charity, basically as a man who tried his best but had a lot of bad luck. And he was an alcoholic. That didn't help things either. He was a musician. He was a tenor. He sang as a salaried musician in the court in Bonn, the elector's court. And he and his wife had 7 children, of which the first and then the last 3 died in infancy. Not that unusual at that time, but still, you can just imagine what a terrible ongoing tragedy this would be for families at that period. And the first child, who was born in April of 1769 and died that very same month, was named Ludwig van Beethoven, after Johann's father. The second child, who was probably born on December 16th of 1770 and lived until 1827, was also named Ludwig van Beethoven, the name having by that time become available again. And here's young Beethoven, possibly Beethoven. We think this is the earliest portrait of Beethoven, a silhouette. Johann had decided that the surviving Ludwig should become a musical prodigy. And so he began giving his son piano and violin lessons at the age of 4 or 5. And young Ludwig did not like it. Later memoirs by his friends are consistent in describing that time. One childhood friend later wrote, described him as, quote, a tiny boy standing on a little footstool in front of the keyboard to which the implacable severity of his father had so early condemned him, weeping. And yet, Johann must have sensed that his son had some inherent musical capacity, and he would have known, as well as anybody, that talent cannot be realized without diligent practice. So he decided that Ludwig should become a musical prodigy, and that is a really lofty goal. In March of 1778, Johann organized a concert in nearby Cologne, right near Bonn, where according to the newspaper advertisement, and there it is, he said, the electoral court tenorist, Beethoven, meaning himself, will have the honor to produce 2 of his scholars, namely Mademoiselle Averdonk, court contraltist, and his little son of 6 years. That was a lie. Young Ludwig was not six, he was eight at that time, and Johann knew that full well, but he clearly felt that shaving off a couple of years would make his son appear all the more impressive. So the announcement then goes on to note that young Ludwig would play various keyboard concertos and trios, and that Johann, quote, flatters himself that the concert will give complete enjoyment to all ladies and gentlemen. Now, at that time, the standard by which a musical prodigy was judged was Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart. In 1778, the year of that Beethoven concert, Mozart was no longer a prodigy. He was growing up. He was touring Europe, looking for a court appointment somewhere, which he failed to get. But he had been a renowned prodigy, appearing at the leading musical capitals in Europe since he was 7 years old, inspiring wonder in all quarters. Well, that did not happen with Beethoven. That concert that his father organized proved to be a one-off event, and there was no demand for a second recital. At about that time, Johann may have thought a backup plan would be wise because he decided to enroll Ludwig in school. He chose an elementary school in Bonn that was called the Tirocinium. Tirocinium, the name Tirocinium was taken from the Latin Tiro, and we still encounter that word infrequently in English as Tyro. Tyro, meaning a beginner at something. So this was a school for beginners, right? An elementary school. And the Tirocinium was, as you might guess, a Latin school intended to prepare students for a curriculum in the upper grades that remained to some extent a holdover from the old trivium and quadrivium. So he had to learn Latin in order to study these things. Well, at school, Ludwig displayed very poor social skills, and he was generally a loner. A schoolmate later wrote, he was distinguished by uncleanliness, negligence, etc. Not a sign to be discovered in him of that spark of genius which glowed so brilliantly in him afterwards. He stayed in elementary school for 4 years, and that was the end of his formal education. Although it was not the end of his book learning. When he died, he left behind a very large library that included books of fiction and nonfiction, drama, poetry, by the likes of Homer, Euripides, Cicero, Shakespeare, Kant, Schiller, Goethe, many bearing margin annotations by Beethoven in his hand, so he obviously read them attentively. Here he is, finding something very interesting about a poem by Goethe that he has. There are 2 question marks and 3 exclamation points. There you go. In fact, his musical skill was growing by leaps and bounds during those years. And now he began to be nurtured by teachers other than his father, and that did the trick for him. In June 1782, young Beethoven filled in as deputy court organist when his own organ teacher, a fellow named Christian Gottlob Neefe, took a brief trip out of town. And 9 months later, Neefe contributed a glowing report of his 11-year-old pupil to a music magazine in Hamburg. He wrote, he plays the piano very skillfully and with power, and he reads at sight very well. He is now training in composition and has had 9 variations for the pianoforte written by him on a march by Ernst Christian Dressler engraved at Mannheim. An 11-year-old pupil having his music published. He continues, he surely would become a second Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart if he were to continue as he has begun. Well, a piece that probably most of you, certainly I, had not really heard before, is that very first piece that Beethoven had published. It's the 9 variations on a theme by Dressler. And we're going to hear it here, played by the pianist, the Russian pianist Mikhail Pletnev. It's 9 variations. We're just going to hear the first few of them. Okay. And it goes on. That's about half the length of the composition. Extraordinary. His first documented composition. Probably he wrote some earlier than that, but this is certainly the first one to be published. And it's a perfectly good piece, predictable in the way that it unrolls, drawing on basic keyboard vocabulary of its time, although actually it does incorporate a few distinctive technical quirks. Surely Beethoven must have been able to play this piece himself, and it actually makes considerable demands on the pianist. And it attests to the fact that at the age of 11, Beethoven was really on the way. Soon he was serving as keyboard player and violist in the court orchestra at Bonn, where he formed some friendships that lasted the rest of his life. He was contributing in an important way to his family's income, earning a reasonable salary as a professional musician. But Bonn was not a very important musical center. So in 1792, Beethoven headed off to Vienna, which was indeed the musical capital of Europe at that time. The elector in Bonn granted him a 6-month leave of absence, but he never returned. Mozart had just died there in Vienna. And Franz Joseph Haydn was still going strong. In fact, Beethoven signed up for composition lessons with Haydn. And although the two of them didn't really get along very well, and so when Haydn headed off to England for an extended tour, Beethoven leapt at the opportunity to study instead with other leading lights in Vienna. And that's when he really began to progress. The 1790s were Beethoven's journeyman years, during which he established his bona fides as a piano virtuoso, made important connections among wealthy musical connoisseurs, dedicated pieces to influential musicians like Haydn and Salieri, and especially dedicated them to titled nobility with deep pockets, a countess, a baroness, princes and princesses, even to Maria Theresa, the Empress of Austria. And he composed a great deal of music. For the most part, his music from the 1790s played by the rules. Like composers and painters and authors of all eras, he wisely busied himself developing the skills of his art as it existed, building up mastery of the musical vocabulary that people understood and that was supremely well codified by figures like Mozart and Haydn. Now, many of you will have received postcards announcing this lecture. So, of course, when mine arrived, the first thing that my eye went to was that line of music up there at the top. I thought, what is that? I wasn't really sure. It looked like the left hand of a piano part, and those notes at the beginning looked very much like Beethoven in a punchy mood. So I started paging through my copy of the Kinsky Beethoven Verzeichnis, which is the chronological thematic catalog of all of his works. And it didn't take me long because, sure enough, there it was already on page 15. A sonata for piano, four hands, probably composed in 1796 or 1797, and published in that later year, 1797, opus 6. And there on the left, you see the first four measures printed to identify the first of the piece's two movements. That's the music that was on the postcard. And I didn't know this composition, although I imagine it is used today as a teaching piece, because the parts for both players are within the reach of pianists who are accomplished, but not necessarily at a professional level. Maybe Rosalie Heller assigned it to some of her more accomplished students, or even performed it with them. Let's give a listen to the first movement. It's short. It's just even less than 3 minutes long. Thank you. Nice little piece, isn't it? Anybody know that piece? I didn't know it. It never gets played. And it's really a pity. That was performed by the Prague Piano Duo, which is a husband and wife. And for those of you who read music and were following along with it, you might have noticed that a wonderful thing about the writing is how close the hands get. The left hand of the pianist sitting at the top of the piano sometimes gets very close to the right hand of the pianist sitting at the bottom of the keyboard. And so these pieces had a great interest to people who played in salons at that time for their romantic possibilities. I got very touchy-feely during these four-hand sonatas. Well, the pieces that Beethoven wrote, especially towards the end of the 1790s, included some that are still considered masterworks. Say his first three piano concertos, his first six string quartets, his 12 earliest piano sonatas, including the beloved Pathétique Sonata. Those were all works from the 1790s. And by the year 1800, he was widely regarded as the finest pianist in Vienna. But in truth, his compositions of that decade rarely reached very far into the avant-garde. In retrospect, we might think of that opening of that Opus 6 sonata as not just punchy, but even musically gruff, perhaps prefiguring the sort of attention-getting opening that Beethoven would write, Beethoven would be writing a decade later. Right? You can kind of hear that bum, 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 especially when you turn it into minor key, bum, 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 bum. You hear where his mind maybe is going. It's not there yet, but he's on the way. Or maybe I'm projecting. Anyway, that four-hand sonata is a fine example of well-turned music that wouldn't have rattled anybody's cages in 1797. The opening in particular did exactly what an opening was supposed to do in the classical period. It defined the key of the piece and the meter and the tempo of the piece. In this case, the key was D major. And those opening measures sound the notes of the D major triumph, bum, 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 bum. So very clearly we're in D major, the basic harmony of that piece. And the meter is 3-4. We could hear it dancing along like a waltz. 1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1-2-3, at a quick tempo. So this is well-behaved music, but within very little time, Beethoven felt ready to break free of expectations, and he did so in an extremely dramatic way. In the very first piece that he completed in the 19th century, it was his Symphony No. 1, which he finished writing in the first months of 1800, and he premiered on April 2nd of that year in a concert that he produced himself. And the program consisted of pieces by Mozart, Haydn, and Beethoven, but mostly Beethoven. So the 30-year-old composer was defining in what company he felt he should be placed by music lovers. And it was received by Vienna's leading music magazine as the most interesting public concert in a long time. Well, I can see why. Beethoven's symphony was the last piece on that concert. And from the very first note, he made it clear that he had something new in mind. Oh, no. There it is. He had something new in mind in the very first note. Let's listen to the first note. That I'm having a misbehaving, my stuff is misbehaving here. Let's try it this way. All right, that was that first note. I want to talk a little bit about that first note. That first note, and I'm going to try to get this back up. I apologize for my technical glitch here. But the very first note is this. Now, that's what, if any of you study music theory, you might know that that's what's called a major minor seventh chord. Okay, so what all that means is that you start with the note that is the basic note, the fundamental note of the chord. The note that's a third above is a major third above. It means that the note that is a seventh above, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, is a minor seventh. It could be a major seventh, but no, it's a minor seventh. So that's a major minor seventh chord. Usually we encounter the major minor seventh chord in what's called the dominant seventh chord. It wants to resolve. It's an unstable chord. You can't just kind of stay there forever. You got to resolve it someplace. Where you have to resolve it to is here, right? And so that's what Beethoven does. He gives you this chord. He spells it this way, spreads it out a little bit bigger. And then, however, he says, oh, I'm not done with it yet. And he continues. And then he has yet further to go with it. And so you say, oh, okay, now we finally got all of this resolved. Now we're where this all was heading. But in fact, we're not. We're at the chord of G major. This piece is going to do a lot of wandering. It started in the most unstable way, and it's going to just keep going. All right, now let me see if I can make this large again, folks. If you will bear with me for a moment, if I do play, good. Let's listen now to that beginning one more time. And you hear the instability, resolution. Done? No. Moving on. Not till that point do we get a C major chord, a pure C major chord. And we figure out, and it continues then in C major for a little bit farther, and we learn finally that's where we were heading. He's been lying all along. He's been faking us out. His resolution to F major and then to G major, these were false promises. He keeps toying with the harmony, leading us wondering where everything's going to touch down. So it really takes 8 measures for it to touch down. And by now we're so distrustful of him that we don't know if he's even to be believed at that point, but he is. The rest of the piece is in C major. So what I'm describing is something that is far more ambiguous than a bum-bum-bum, which tells us what the tempo is, what the meter is, what the key is. In this case, we have no idea what the key is. It's slow enough that we really don't know what the meter is, and we don't really know what the tempo is. So Beethoven is doing something extremely creative here. There are a tiny handful of earlier pieces that opened with a dissonance, but this is the first case I know of where a symphony opens with a dissonance, the symphony being the genre that is the most imposing statement that that a composer could possibly make at that time. So this is really an extraordinary thing. In fact, I think that this was the most extraordinary opening of any symphony written up until that time. It's not the most extraordinary symphony, but it's the most extraordinary opening to a symphony. So Beethoven enters the new century having shown that he's achieved mastery in the forms and methods of standard music making, like sonatas, variations, and that he's ready to enter the big time by unveiling a symphony. And he does that in such an unorthodox and audacious way. This is really making a big entrance. Now, unfortunately, his health was not so good. Beethoven's biography is full of doctors. In 1797, he fell seriously ill. He may have had typhus, an infectious disease that in those days often proved fatal. He got through it. But from then on, illness became a recurrent part of his life. We have documentary evidence of at least 14 physicians who treated Beethoven for various ailments in his lifetime. Although we appreciate today that there was just so much that could be accomplished with bleeding and leeches and that sort of thing. One of Beethoven's longest lasting friends, in fact, was a physician, a man he had already known as a young fellow back in Bonn, named Dr. Franz Wegeler. And in June of 1801, Beethoven, who had been out of touch for a while, caught up by writing Dr. Wegeler a long, newsy letter. "My compositions bring me in a great deal," Beethoven writes, "and I may say that I am offered more commissions than it's possible for me to carry out. Moreover, for every composition, I can count on 6 or 7 publishers, and even more if I want them. People no longer come to an arrangement with me. I state my price, and they pay. So you see how pleasantly situated I am." But then he broaches another topic, the first time it comes up in any surviving document. "That jealous demon, my wretched health, has put a nasty spoke in my wheel, and it amounts to this, that for the last 3 years, my hearing has become weaker and weaker. Dr. Franck tried to tone up my constitution with strengthening medicines and my hearing with almond oil, but that hasn't done me any good." He goes on and on about his stomach and his digestive problems, which come and go, but the hearing issue remains a constant. "For almost 2 years," he writes, "I have ceased to attend any social function just because I find it impossible to say to people, I am deaf. If I had any other profession, I might be able to cope with my infirmity, but in my profession, it's a terrible handicap. Already I have often cursed my creator and my very existence. I live entirely within my music." As we know, Beethoven's hearing would not improve. It would get worse, and eventually he would become totally deaf. And a year later, a year later, in October of 1802, while he was on vacation in the village of Heiligenstadt, now subsumed into Vienna proper, Beethoven wrote a despondent letter to his brothers, Karl and Johann, in which he reveals his deafness to them and the extent to which it has isolated him from people and caused even a fissure in their relationship, his relationship with those two brothers. "Oh, you men who think and say that I am malevolent, stubborn, or misanthropic, how greatly do you wrong me," he began, before explaining that "for 6 years I have been a hopeless case, aggravated by senseless physicians, cheated year after year in the hope of improvement, finally compelled to face the prospect of a lasting malady. It was virtue that upheld me in misery," he wrote. "To it, next to my art, I owe the fact that I did not end my life in suicide." He didn't send the letter. A week later, he appended a little addendum stating that his brothers should read it after his death. And that is the point where I will leave off with Beethoven, at that moment of almost unbearable poignancy when he was at the height of acclaim as a piano virtuoso and as a composer was forging into the future with extraordinary creativity. But he recognized that his deafness could bring everything crashing down. He did continue to perform as a pianist, although with decreasing frequency and accuracy, until he just couldn't do it anymore. He made his last public appearance as a pianist in 1814, playing in his Archduke Trio, perhaps the most glorious piece in all of chamber music. An observer reported there was scarcely anything left of the virtuosity that had formerly been so greatly admired. But here's the miracle. As we all know, Beethoven did not give up. He continued to live within his music, just as he had explained to Dr. Wegeler back in 1801 when he first acknowledged that this was happening to him. But ultimately, he shifted lanes. He gave up being a pianist and devoted himself entirely to composition. he still had 8 symphonies in him, and bunches of piano sonatas and string quartets and piano trios and an opera and sacred music and all sorts of other things. And he found that even in the face of deafness, music would not exclude him. It was an anchor in a life that continued to present tremendous difficulties, both medical and otherwise, but he could still live within his music. It was a private sanctuary, a shelter against the vicissitudes of life, the thing that most linked him to a world beyond himself. History serves up many other examples of composers for whom music was not just a profession, but a way to navigate obstacles that life threw in their way. I think of other composers who suffered from hearing impairments, like Bedřich Smetana, who in his autobiographical first string quartet titled From My Life actually wrote a high-pitched note that represented the tinnitus that signaled the onset of what would become his total deafness. There we go. A heartbreaking piece, truly. Or I think of Gabriel Fauré, who towards the end of his life could no longer bear to hear music played because his oral perception grew grotesquely distorted, making him hear all notes as horribly out of tune, even when they weren't. And yet, he continued to write scores of exquisite delicacy. I think of Dmitri Shostakovich, who for decades was the victim of political bullying from Joseph Stalin and his Soviet minions. Poor Shostakovich, he grew sick and paranoid, but he kept going, thanks to music, composing pieces that he assumed would earn official reprimands if they were known. And so instead, he tucked them away in his desk drawer, where they would be waiting in case better times should come. And I think of Sergei Rachmaninoff, who, like Beethoven, hoped to make a big splash with his first symphony. And then, the day after it was premiered, in 1897, he read this newspaper review, authored by the composer César Cui. If there were a conservatory in hell, if one of its talented students were instructed to write a program symphony on the 7 plagues of Egypt, and if he were to compose a symphony like Mr. Rachmaninoff's, then he would have fulfilled his task brilliantly and would bring delight to the inhabitants of hell. Ouch. In the psychological aftermath of that embarrassment, he simply turned to a different musical pursuit, and he focused on conducting for the next few years. A hypnotist steered him back toward composing, and by 1901, Rachmaninoff was able to compose and unveil his Piano Concerto No. 2, which remains very much played and beloved to this day. One of the greatest of piano concertos. He still had it in him. Music was broad enough to provide Rachmaninoff a pathway through those 4 years during which a mental block prevented him from composing, and it was waiting for him when he came back. And I think of Franz Schubert. Benjamin Britten once wrote, "It is arguable that the richest and most productive 18 months in our musical history is the time when Beethoven had just died, when the other 19th century giants, Wagner, Verdi, and Brahms, had not yet begun. It was the period in which Franz Schubert wrote his Winterreise, the C major symphony, his last three piano sonatas, the C major string quintet, as well as a dozen other glorious pieces. The very creation of these works in that space of time seems hardly credible, but the standard of inspiration, of magic, is miraculous and past all explanation." Well, yes, that is arguably true. And speaking of Winterreise, I would point out to you that it's going to be presented right here in Los Alamos in December by one of our great singers, Eric Owens, and I believe pianist Jeremy Denk. So you will not want to miss it, one of the pieces from these magical 18 months at the end of Schubert's life. And it was the end of Schubert's life because he was staring death in the face. Late in 1822, he had contracted syphilis, an incurable disease at that time, and within months he grew so ill that he required a lengthy hospitalization. His symptoms subsided somewhat, but he had no delusions about where this disease was likely to lead. The time between diagnosis and death rarely reached 10 years, and it was usually a good deal less. So in those months of 1827 and 1828, he was 5 or 6 years in. In 1824, he had written to a friend, "In a word, I feel myself to be the most unhappy and wretched creature in the world. Imagine a man whose health will never be right again. Imagine a man whose most brilliant hopes have perished, to whom the felicity of love and friendship have nothing to offer but pain." And yet, Schubert continued to live within his music. At just the time that he received his diagnosis, he embarked on his unfinished symphony and the Wanderer fantasy, masterpieces both. And from then until the time he died at the age of 31, he completed more than 200 further compositions. So I think it is only just that we give the last musical word to Franz Schubert, because it is his song, "An die Musik," to music, that gives most perfect voice to this idea about the capacity to nourish, that music has to nourish us through times good and bad, which is what inspired me, as I said before, so much about the life of Rosalie Heller. Let's listen to this irreplaceable song, and it's going to be performed by the most golden voice of all tenors, Fritz Wunderlich, accompanied by pianist Hubert Giesen. This is a live a live recording that was made on September 4th, 1966, at the Usher Hall in Edinburgh, Scotland, part of the Edinburgh Festival. And it was part of the last recital that Fritz Wunderlich ever sang. A couple of weeks later, he died after tumbling down a staircase at a friend's hunting lodge. He tripped on untied shoelaces, Giesen said. So let's give Schubert the last musical word, the last musical word of this evening. Schubert's song is an anthem to the universal sustaining power of music and is not available to musicians alone. It is a gift to any of us. Let us not forget that it is there. At some point, it may be essential for each of us to live within our music. Thank you for joining me tonight. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Oh, you are too kind. It's been such a pleasure speaking with you tonight, and I wanted to say that I'm very happy to entertain some question or discussion, as long as it's well-centered, for a few minutes. If anybody has anything they'd like to ask about the lecture or anything else that's on your mind, I'm here at your disposal. Surely we have a brave song. Oh, yes, sir.
Your instrument was what, oboe?
My instrument was the oboe, yes.
And did you perform professionally
with
it, or how did you deviate from orchestra?
Yes, well, yes, it was the oboe. You know, the oboe is a difficult instrument. There was a famous oboe player named Robert Bloom. He became a distinguished pedagogue as well. He taught at Yale for many, many years. And people used to ask Robert Bloom, is it true that all oboe players go crazy? And he said, no, that's not strictly true. The fact is they're crazy before they begin. But I loved playing the oboe. But in truth, and I went to conservatory as an oboe player, and I did perform some. But I really, my I loved the history of music. That's what I loved more than performing music. And I also had what I now realize was a repetitive stress injury. In those days, people didn't talk about that, but a lot of now we do. And a lot of musicians get derailed by repetitive stress injuries. In my case, it was from making reeds. Oboists all have, you know, you blow through a reed, and they're tiny, and oboists all make their own. And you do it by holding very tightly a little tiny piece of cane that comes from the French Riviera and a sharp knife, and you just keep twisting and cutting these things in the most tiny way, but it's all repetitive. And you do this thousands of times every day of your life as an oboist. And I had pain. It was going like that and couldn't deal with it. So I didn't enjoy playing the oboe very much because it was a painful experience. So I basically gave it up, and I never have regretted it. I still have my oboe. Sometime I'd like to learn to play it again, but oh, the muscles are out of shape. But it was the history of music that most appealed to me, and I continued then, did my graduate work in music history, and it's been a wonderful profession for me. I'm one of the rather few people, I think, who has made a profession in the history of music outside of academia. Because I don't teach on any faculty, but I get to communicate as a generalist to music lovers, and that's a wonderful thing.
Well, let's thank our speaker.
Thank you, Leon.